So, Professor Gaspar Miklos Tomas, I now mentioned his full name. In Hungary, where you have the surname first, he's best known for the abbreviation TGM. And we already discussed it. Unfortunately, for my Czech friends, that's really a sacrilege to use this shortening of TGM, which is reserved for the first president of the country, Tomáš Garrigue Masaryk. Professor Tomáš is a Hungarian philosopher, prolific writer of essays, and a quite outspoken voice in the political arena of today, I'd say. He mainly lives in Budapest, recently is a frequent speaker at demonstration or left-wing gatherings, and one of the most articulate and well-known proponents of European Marxism, sometimes also characterized as heretical European Marxism. I leave it to Mr. Professor Tomáš himself and maybe to our discussion in how far this epithet of the heretical is adequate. He is a former dissident whose views on political theory and philosophy gradually over the course of the years shifted to the left. And one of those persons where the intellectual and academic biography is somewhat inseparable from the political biography. So in my short presentation of him, I will not try to separate these things, but try to somewhat keep them together. Born in Kolozsvár or Cluj in Transylvania in Romania, Professor Tomáš worked as an associate editor of a Hungarian language literary weekly, but was soon backlisted from publishing and harassed by the secret police of the Ceausescu regime. In 1978, he was forced to emigrate, and at that point he decided to emigrate to socialist Hungary instead of one country in the West, for example, France, where he could always have gone to. And he has commented in one of his interviews, he has commented on this decision, what made him go to Hungary instead of a possible stay in the West. I will not go into this, but I find it is an interesting detail in his biography. He taught for 2 years at the University of Budapest, but was fired for having published illegal tracts in Samizdat. And then subsequently became engaged in the East European dissident movements. From 1986 to the present day, he has held a number of visiting appointments. It's not needed to mention all of them, just a few: Columbia, Oxford, École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales, Wissenschaftskolleg zu Berlin, Georgetown, New School in New York. The list could be extended. He was elected to Parliament in 1990 and also elected director of the Institute of Philosophy of the Hungarian Academy of Sciences in 91. But from both positions, he stepped down a few years later in 1994, respectively 1995. So a biography, as we could say, of multiple dissidents or multiple opposition. Dissident in socialist Romania, dissidents in socialist Hungary, and to some extent also a dissidence or at least an opposition to the political scene of today. From his many publications, I'd like to mention four. The first one and the oldest one, a study about the moral essence of national feelings under the title The Idols of the Tribe, but actually published in French language in 1991. Then a longer essay, a somewhat famous essay by Mr. Tomáš, Telling the Truth About Class, published in Socialist Register in 2006, an article that deals with the idea of the proletariat in what Tomáš calls, on the one hand, a Rousseauian and on the other hand, a Marxist or Marxian tradition, whereby he thinks, and that is one of the main ideas of this article, that most of what we normally consider Marxist and most of what people themselves consider to be Marxist is in fact Rousseauian. Thirdly, a book entitled Innocent Power. It was published in relation to the German Documenta in Kassel in 2012. Professor Tomáš himself called this once a romantic publication. It deals with the question of political alternatives for present day. And finally, and this book I have here with me, a book that came out last year in Vienna, Kommunismus nach 1989, a collection of essays by him in German translation. And what I find very nice about this book, a collection of essays accompanied or accomplished by two longer interviews with him that really give like a extra substantial reading to this book. To finish my presentation, in an interview in 2013, published in the New Leftist Review, he said, and I quote him, "I don't regret for a moment having fought against the socialist regime, for it was mendacious, stupid, brutal, repressive, and treacherous. And I still do emotionally identify with the dissidents of those years. But what I dislike very much are the results of those struggles." End of quote. So, as a statement that already gives us a clear idea about his political development, but maybe also a statement that raises a number of questions that we can maybe tackle in the subsequent discussion of tonight. To mention one final thing, Professor Tomasz is also very engaged in current debates of today, also in the so-called refugee or migrant debate. And from the same interview, I quote one short sentence by him where he says, "Europe may become a larger Rhodesia any time now." So what he means by this, there might be several meanings, but it's probably a criticism of the idea of not giving universal citizenship, but making citizenship available only to the officially registered populations of the Western nation states. Tonight, Professor Tomasz will speak about solidarity. And the title is Solidarity Possible in a Reified Society? Professor Tomasz, the floor is yours, please.
Thank you so much. You said that I'm participating frequently in left-wing demonstrations. Well, that's the past, because there are no left-wing demonstrations and rallies and such in my country, but there might be again, who knows. Very unlikely places. You've seen signs of resistance, even the most reactionary country of the present, which is France. Well, so let me read what I have written down for you. One of the most enduring topoi of political philosophy is, at least since Plato, that particular interests and passions combined with ignorance are the major obstacles in the way of a rational ordering of public affairs. Such an ordering is supposed, however hopelessly, to be subordinated to the search of and to a commitment to truth. Great conservative thinkers, from Confucius to Max Weber, propose to remedy this sorry state of all societies through political education, permitting the penetration of reason into a realm of passion and power, while acknowledging the need for the inevitable compromise of the noble lie. Humans should be cajoled into a permanent preoccupation with justice and the just order through inflaming their imagination and through appealing to their self-regard. And of course, by introducing them to the charms of theory, which once experienced should leave an indelible trace in people's souls. The whole idea is inspired by the hypothesis that passions are necessarily selfish and that reason is not. This has been contradicted both by the Gospels and by the radical revolutionary strand of the Enlightenment, from Spinoza to Rousseau and beyond. The radical innovation of Christianity, of course, is to value faith more than knowledge. Moral intuition, subject to divine approval, whether paradoxical or self-evident, trumps philosophy every time. The Sermon on the Mount affirms these paradoxa, opposed to the world as the sublime examples of ineffable justice and extols the virtue of defeat over triumph, of superiority of the weak over the strong. This, too, is of course confronted by passion, selfishness, and desire. The assumption that there are generous passions, that there is a thirst for this worldly justice, is wholly new. This is why solidarity is understood, still, as a sentimental notion, bereft of conceptual force, however heartwarming and lovely. This is why description has been a privilege of the arts. This is why Marx's idea that the class interests of the proletariat do objectively coincide with the general interest of the emancipation of all mankind is a philosophic construction, Platonist or Hegelian, but distinctly non-Rousseauian. Empirically, however, the emotional reality of the international workers' movement and of all great revolutions had been a passion for justice, a desire of transcending selfishness within and without, a combination of inner, effective, and moral reform with a change of external circumstances. The task is to analyze the inherent conceptual content of such a passion and desire. The genre in which this has been attempted is political theology. We should briefly examine its claims and their validity. Setting aside the particulars of revolutionary and apocalyptic political theology, from Ernst Bloch's Münzer book to Walter Benjamin, to the Comité Invisible of the Parti Imaginaire, and the conservative responses from Carl Schmitt to Leo Strauss, to Karl Löwit, to Jakob Taubes, to Norman Cohn, it is not very difficult to explain why moral ideas such as justice or solidarity cannot find their place in an ethical system any longer, and why does it become necessary to incorporate them in the framework of something resembling religious faith, mostly of the atheist variety. As noted in Alain Badiou's perceptive essay on Ricoeur, the works of memory, law and history, enjoined by the old covenant, have been smashed by the Gospels as forgiving calls for oblivion. Not only does forgiving and mercy supersede law and ethics, and it does moreover annihilate history in the process, but it calls for immediate faith, that is, for a non-ethical idea of goodness. This idea of goodness is a fundamental thought, as you may know, of the very young Lukács, inspired as he was by Kierkegaard. In the case of the Gospels, it is the unredeemed state of the soul and its expectation of redemption through faith, conversion, and works, as it was called by Luther, good deeds. In the case of Marxian communism, it is reification and the hope of emancipation through revolution, which is the insuperable obstacle, and its contrary paired with it, the two bridged by an irrational leap of faith over the chasm. The problem with reification, as described by Marx and Lukács, is the following. By the sale of labor time and labor power, and by the transformation of living labor into dead labor, and by value becoming the measure of all that's happening in human existence, mediated by money, the market, state planning, or whatever, living beings are to be changed into thing-like partial substances. The limitations imposed by work are not subordinated to the human will of another. Domination is not primarily personal or even social, but abstract and objectual at the same time. The human essence expressed by work can be externalized or estranged like any other commodity, and regarded by other persons as observers, it would appear as a thing. And conversely, capital, regarded in its totality a huge collection of commodities, as it's well known, will appear as a concept. A concept abstracted from myriads of acts of valorification while steering them through value, a concept which is concomitantly an abstraction, a command, e.g. to accumulate, to expand, to become more while remaining itself, becoming more while remaining itself being the very miracle of capital, and an essence within each act, person, thing, all reduced at the same level of thingishness, of objectuality. Subjecthood, interpreted as effect, desire, and freedom, appears as self-delusion, at least in part. Subjecthood, understood in a thoroughly materialist, say Spinozist fashion, cannot account for its servitude to the concept. A conceptual ordering of society, as it were, from the bottom up, will always fail to explain servitude, let alone alienation, because it will be forced to simplify it as caused by interest, the conatus of the masters. Materialism in this sense is by necessity political and will suppose that, to put it simply, the supersession of class rule as domination of persons by other persons or of persons by political institutions, such as private property as established by Roman law, will result in the suppression of unfreedom, hence of reification. But this cannot be. It cannot, because the fetishism of the commodity presents the reified as living and subjective, and vice versa. Unlike in other societies, in capitalism the mere change of political institutions cannot change the very nature of domination. If the conceptual, hence impersonal and non-political rule of capital continues, the identity of the owner of property, an individual, a joint stock company, or the state, is not decisive if the sale and purchase of labor power and labor time goes on unabated. Liberationist political projects, however noble and sometimes quite effective in a limited sense, are unavoidably products of false consciousness. The thirst for justice, self-abnegation, and self-sacrifice in the service of the good cause are a reality that nobody can or should deny. Equality is a regulative idea which, if implemented politically, can change a great deal in society, especially besides its material and social advantages, it can put an end to humiliation at the hand of superior instances and castes. No equitable redistribution, nor any sort of socialized production can, however, nullify reification that is consubstantial with exploitation by concept if commodity production, money, etc., remain in place. Liberation that misses the main target of any insurgency aiming at the cessation of oppression is bound to stay partial at best if the dominion of commodity production and wage labor is basically the same under an egalitarian, fair, and just regime. It is rather clear and borne out by what we know of modern history that forcing the common good upon a reified humanity will create new difficulties, as it cannot be sustained without violence. And we are speaking here of a violence which must, and there is no exception, be exercised on people's minds as self-abnegation, self-sacrifice necessary for upholding a fair and just regime, is a moral condition inspired by injustice and the desire to suppress it. Why should people sacrifice their private interests in a just society? Probably because private interests and the public interest do not coincide still. Therefore, it is risky to assume that ultimate and true social justice has been or can be indeed achieved. If individual desires, aspirations, interests can be contrasted with the public interest and with the common good, the normal condition of bourgeois society, then individuality and subjectivity will have to rebel against the common good and affirm that the common good is not sufficiently common after all. This is again the normal condition of bourgeois society and the cause of assertiveness of individuality, called by Hegel the unhappy consciousness, the birthmark of modern art. The common good appears as a sham, trickery, or illusion. The view of the Philistine from Karenin to Monsieur Bovary, not to speak of Bouvard and Pécuchet, shown to be utterly ridiculous by all our avant-gardes. A distaste for egalitarian sentimentality is one of the chief merits of an otherwise delinquent ultra-left. But it is exactly this egalitarian sentimentality that fills our everyday, at least of those who mean to fight against discrimination, oppression, tyranny, and the like. Solidarity is a moral idea, bringing together people from different vantage points, people with social and cultural privileges and without, identifying themselves with the less privileged, neutralizing self-interest, and realizing politically and morally some version of the idea of the brotherhood of man. And this is surely contaminated by false consciousness. Solidarity, although once again it is a moral idea, is and can be only a means towards something else. It may be a Vorwegnahme, a preemption of a non-repressive situation. The other name for such anticipation is, of course, utopia. A subjectivation of objectivity. What on earth can possibly be the meaning of such an anticipated just and equal community under the reign of the concept that makes us into things? How can solidarity exist if there are serious doubts about personhood, about the sovereignty of the subjective? After the earth-shattering defeats of the 20th century, radical thinkers have tried to decompose and relativize subjectivity, a bastion of bourgeois sentiment. On the other hand, oppression appears as an ethnic factor, the hegemony of the West, already familiar from late Roman historiography. So the fragmentation of identity psychologically, culturally, and ethnically, the power of power within the moral eye, constitute a dialectic in which involuntary servitude, inherent in the late capitalist ego and superego, might be the substrate of liberation opposed to the dictate of an unbelievable common good. The new moralism of a thoroughgoing condemnation of the bourgeois I, a sinful identity, might point at solidarity as a break with universality, as triation, rupture, as renunciation of truth, as suspicion of morals. Non-identity, difference, diversity, plurality, conflictuality, is supposed to be the heir of political ideas such as internationalism, that is showing class to be a non-identical substance of bourgeois society, as discovered and proposed by the workers' movement, in other words, by communism. The dialectical assumption of non-identity can be, of course, at the center of an anti-Bovary movement, more inspired, you hear in the sense of beseelt. Duden says this means, first, eine Seele besitzend, second, von einem Gefühl innerlich erfüllt sein, and third, in Gefühlen schwelgend, gefühlvoll, sentimental, that is, soulful, ensouled, inspirited, by a clash than by unity or union. The impossibility of an alliance of subjectivities as non-identities makes solidarity into a device of a global civil war, rather reminiscent, albeit in a passive way of the Comintern worldview. But the Comintern, or rather Lukács, substituted the hypothetical non-reified and non-alienated truth to the moral idea, and the belief in such a truth is signally lacking now. That truth was believed to be embodied in a supra-social elite, beseeled and sold by philosophy, known as the party, akin to the old Platonic solution. Such a solution is politically impossible, even unthinkable today. The Rousseauian idea of equality as the guarantee of the common good and of human union within a circumscribed political historical landscape is slightly more plausible, but it would probably contradict any universalist idea of solidarity. But as capital is universal, local solidarities are powerless. This is the written part, to which I will have to add a few rather simpler ideas, referring also to the actual stand of the problem solidarity. I was asked repeatedly, including earlier today in Vienna, that how do I interpret the persistence of the term solidarity in the European Union documents, of all places, while I affirm that solidarity as a fighting notion has no place in such a society as ours. The explanation is very simple. The notion of solidarity, as contained in the official documents of today, has two distinct senses. The one is the social state, that is, social help to the needy and to the subaltern, the welfare state idea, that's the solidarity between various social groups. After all, liberal states, liberal regimes of rule of law are systems of equilibrium between different groups and different instances. Rather, like according to the Aristotelian definition of democracy as the equality of the unequal. And the second sense in which, this term is employed is, of course, peace. Peace between nation states. These are the double, you know, aims of the European Union, which are parallel to the ideas within liberal bourgeois societies, in which indeed solidarity, that has other origins, is superimposed by the idea of tolerance, which means a peaceful equilibrium within a society between different forces, communities, groups, identities, and such, among whom and among which otherwise relationships of inequality, of subordination, and of widely diverging amount of power belongs. Tolerance is necessary and possible only in unequal societies. And of course, it means that lack of power, lack of riches, lack of education, lack of this and that and the other, won't be used against this group, and the protection of the states, of course, is valid for all, provided that toleration is mutual, that I, your humble speaker today, I will tolerate the IMF and the US Army, and the IMF and the US Army promises to tolerate me. It is a rather unequal relationship. Nevertheless, it obtains to a certain extent, as far as I am not too radical in speaking or acting against the IMF or the US Army. That one thing, as I said, is toleration. Toleration, which is directly antithetical to solidarity, because solidarity presupposes the formation of a political community in which the question of true desert cannot be asked. Just look at the current refugee problem, as the most well-known today. So people, quite relatively decent people, would say, do we need more authoritarian fundamentalist, religious fanatics, despisers of women, etc., etc.? Don't we have enough of them already? Do they deserve the solidarity of nice, kind, well-educated, tolerant Democrats? So that's a good question for a good bourgeois, because indeed, in a tolerant liberal society, the question of the price of toleration is deservedly and legitimately asked. Solidarity is different. Solidarity doesn't ask. Solidarity in this sense is like divine love, which is universal, and which indeed, as Apostle Paul has said very loudly, that divine love, the love of God, does not select people, does not choose. And solidarity doesn't choose. It forms a new, if you wish, utopian community by its fight. It's a fighting concept, Kampfbegriff. And it doesn't only create links, emotional, political, moral, and other links between persons, but proposes a society in which solidarity, that is a preempted, equal, just, and free society, is the ideal image of what should be the moral rule of solidarity. So you see, when we compare earlier instances of solidary political action, such as sending armed people into civil wars to help the good side, or organizing mass strikes against the loading and unloading of goods benefiting reactionary states, etc., or organizing illegal political strikes in order to help other groups protesting, and so on. In these cases, it wasn't a question of helping the needy. It wasn't a question of the powerful helping the powerless, because that's what we do, myself included. That's what we do when we are bringing coats and blankets and shoes and sandwiches to the needy, and when we are protesting in the face of buildings, housing, institutions and instances, which by our very act of complaint and protest declare as legitimate. And so therefore, but at the same time, you see, in all these movements trying to help the poor refugees and so on and so forth, the idea of solidarity will appear again and again. Why and how? Well, in my opinion, it appears simply as a desire for solidarity. It is not an act of solidarity, it's not a practice of solidarity, but it is a dream of solidarity, solidarity as an embodied utopia in which people don't even attempt to create a solidary society or a society in which solidarity can be principle organizing political aspirations and struggles, but they are desirous of and dreaming of a collective state of mind in which solidarity as a political practice is possible. But it isn't. But it isn't possible because, you see, everybody, virtually everybody, including those people who have a very low opinion of it, would recognize a diverse society, hence a society in need of toleration and of inner equilibrium and of authority in control of conflicts that can temper, postpone, quiet down, and cool conflicts. For this you need a state. And by demanding toleration being extended to people to whom it has not been extended to date, you recognize the primordial inequality of the elements of this equilibrium. In other words, you recognize liberal capitalism as it is. And the question, can you fight injustice in a society whose very foundations of injustice you at the same time recognize, however reluctantly and critically? I leave to you the answer. You can suspect mine. But the problem is genuine. Are we not fooling ourselves when we are trying to return to political ideas and even moral and philosophical ideas, if you wish, that have foundations that we don't recognize any longer? Christian or communist or other, and in which a symbolism is expressed that is not precisely mendacious, but it is less or more morally recognizing the inner contradiction and the inner inconsistency of the worldview of those who would like to change the world by the afraid that they might not be able to. And this combination of recognition and withdrawal of recognition, of complaint and protest, of using the imagery and the metaphoric of fight, even of civil war, by the symbolism of calling your enemy fascist. I will stop at this because it's a very good example of what I have in mind. And so on, all by this symbolic or metaphoric, we're not pretending, but we are presenting to ourselves the utopian image of ourselves as people still capable of political action that is transformative, while we know that we aren't. But at the same time, keeping the reservatio mentalis, the not so hidden thought contrary to what we do. Why do we still, well, at least most of us, use the word fascist against extreme right people and forces and parties and so on and so forth? Well, of course, the conditions for classical fascism are not here, and indeed, classical fascism or national socialism indeed is not present. Many things are reminiscent of it, of one or two or three or 20 elements of it, but it's still not a complete thing for various and obvious historical reasons. But why is that? Why is it so persistent? Why do we still feel it's not just propaganda? Why I am myself sometimes tempted to call fascists fascists? You see what I'm doing. And the following. Well, fascism, as opposed to other things that we are fighting for, is famous for one thing. It has been defeated. It has been defeated. That's its specific. You know? And when Frederick Jameson said that it is easier to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism, well, that's what he said, it's a very good saying, popular too, deservedly so. Then he's put the finger on something very important. Namely, that tacitly, all of us, including the most radicals sometimes, suppose as ultimate realists that things are not going to change. That the enemy is defined as victorious, as indeed it has been first intimated by people in the summer of 1914, when socialists of the whole world have discovered that for whatever they have been living and fighting was considered by everybody, by virtually everybody, as being irrelevant, class irrelevant, nation relevant, and that the whole world collapsed around them, and they had to change their thinking and their language, and they did. The language of Lenin and of Rosa Luxemburg are not identical with the language of Marx. And the thinking of it, because the enemy was different, and imperialism, and so on. Now, you see, the experience of 1914 and the subsequent defeats of socialism and of other nice things of that kind, mostly at the hands of socialists themselves, or of other socialists, that, of course, is a massive experience which is not only empirical. It is a way in which the left, the cultural left, and the philosophical left, and sometimes the political left too, brings its romanticism and its enthusiasm from the hidden conviction that a good cause is bound to be defeated. That it's not going to result in any real power of the good cause, which might be problematic. And so therefore, the hatred against the things as they are now have to appear in a mythological, within a mythological image, and the mythological image of an identifiable and defeated enemy who symbolizes the evil energy of our adversary, but of course it doesn't. Because you see, the states that are doing now this nasty thing to the refugees, and other nasty things to others, but I will neglect for simplicity's sake, are not fascist states. Are not at all fascist states. They are, well, imperfect, but still existing, normal, average, capitalist, liberal democracies. There has been no coup d'etat. There has been no military putsch. No major European country has been occupied except in the fantasy of the right by Arabs. Of course, the rule of law and liberalism of these states is decaying and, of course, is in a crisis and it's on the brink of collapse and so on. Still, the governments of these states are following the public opinion, of course, partly manipulated by themselves, but still are following public opinion, are accepting the results of voting. Not many people are in prison for voicing dissident opinions for the moment. Well, in Russia, yes, but you know, but in most EU member states and similar arrangements, no. How are you to fight for tolerating immigrant foreigners and against the moral and political order that founds toleration? It's a rather difficult undertaking, I would say. And it is especially intuitively difficult, and it makes political orientation especially onerous. And so you see, this is because, you see, the old problem that has been discovered in 1917, that the consciousness that is being shaped within bourgeois society empirically, it's not reliable to rejuvenate the world and change it from the bottom up and change its foundations, but those analytical tools and theories and truth have to be found independently. They cannot be found by society as it is. Hence the Communist Party, right? And the solution of the Communist Party may not be the perfect one, and I suspect it isn't. So it would appear. But the problem exists. How is it possible to transcend with inner mundane and implicit fights within such a society, with a non-changed consciousness, so that the end result will be a radical change, a transformative change that can be morally described as well? It is probably impossible. It's probably impossible. So when I hear people speaking of solidarity, including sometimes myself, although I may avoid the term, but I won't avoid the whole thing. and when I hear them and myself, so I hear us speaking or thinking of solidarity, it is quite clear that this is a mental recreation, the moral recreation of the international workers' movement that ceased to exist, definitively and probably forever. And that the worldview to be kept and to be safeguarded is such that we don't trust just moral paroles and enjoyments and commands, but we want action, political action, and morality and social transformation, as indeed was the task of revolutionary times. Because you see, if you separate out the moral task, you have left the revolutionary view. The moral task, toleration, goodness, acceptance, generosity, magnanimity, and such like, is perfectly possible in any society. Because it's taking an onerous individual moral task on yourself. For this, you don't need the liberation of humankind. You don't need anything. You just need courage. And but of course, it's much better to think that this is not so. In other words, you're not alone. Simply, that's the feeling that you are not alone in taking a moral stand, which is a solitary act always, even if millions are doing it. And so it is not only nostalgia, it is maybe a deeper need of being at the same time moral beings and people desirous of deep social transformation, which can be a matter beyond the obvious kinds of rationality, and at the same time an acting citizen of a community of your choice, and not of the present thing that has been forced upon you, as indeed it has been always forced on everybody who was born in any human society. And so therefore, I think that in this form, to speak of solidarity is an illusion. It's used just, you know, a sentimental slogan, I have nothing against it. But, you know, it's me, of course, I too need sometimes sentimental slogans. We are all fallible. But the thing is that we should not think that these things, these ideas of solidarity and social justice and thirst for justice and self-sacrifice, in this very simple form, are reconcilable with the critical view of capitalist society, because it isn't. And thank you.
So thank you, Professor Tamás, for this, I'd say, skeptical, if not to say rather bleak, view on the possibilities and on the possible beneficiary effects of something called solidarity. You actually, does this work? Is this okay for you?
Yeah.
You actually used the very same word that Marx himself already used in connection to solidarity when speaking about the happenings in Paris. He says this is only sentimentality, and this solidarity, this sentimental approach, it will not help to bring things about. It will not accelerate things, but if anything at all, it might just stop them from happening, namely the changes that have to happen, and that solidarity will not foster, but will only like make more invisible. Thank you also for keeping your time limit quite precisely, so we have a lot of time for discussion. I think this is good. I guess you like the discussion. I know very many people here in the room like that. But let me maybe start with one opening question to you. So if you rather clearly rejected the concept of solidarity as this sentimentality. If you do that in keeping with Marx, we can somewhat presuppose what your countermodel is. But nevertheless, I think you have not really outlined it in your talk. So, I mean, we agree, I think, that the work on changes in society is something that has to happen, the work for a just society. How do you imagine these changes to happen in society?
Okay, my stock answer to such question is always that I will present the government program immediately as I'm designated prime minister. But otherwise, it's not incumbent upon me to say anything. But I will.
Please.
But I will. Namely, I will because in a very limited sense. Only because you see, I really don't believe in the fight for a just society. Because I don't think that reflects sufficiently well what people in this room, including those who are not present in body but only through their writings, have taught us about human society. And you see, of course, a thirst for justice, to use this time-honored term, exists. Many of us, when thinking about society, even in the most minimal way, would consider, more or less instinctively, not sometimes, sometimes yes, sometimes not, whether the social experience around us is acceptable or not, will it correspond to an ideal justice in a minimal way at least, or not, should we let it happen or should we resist it, and so on and so forth. That's perfectly normal. And then you encounter authority. And authority, of course I'm simplifying, will tell you, through its representatives and thinkers, not that the threat of justice is not noble, but that your concept of justice is wrong. So, you know, already at the second step, when you're considering the fight for justice in society, philosophical problems are being posed. First of all, for example, you know, you ought to pose the problem whether justice indeed is such an unhistorical concept that can be analytically described, as indeed it has been attempted many times, or that a society that is unchanged in its basic features can really aim at justice, when justice by necessity in such a state will have to mean some things. Let me again quote a very minimal example. People would say, for example, and they have been saying it for millennia, that some riches are undeserved. Now, there are some people who are not honest, not hardworking, not generous, not noble of soul, who are still very rich. And the distribution of goods and of riches is unfair. But there are people more deserving of such riches and the instruments that riches put at your disposal than others. And so, therefore, what would be the solution to this unsatisfactory state of affairs? It would be, of course, to confiscate part of the goods of some and offer it to others. Right? That's, of course, the essence of redistribution in a moralizing formulation. And let's suppose that this is possible, that you can really say that who deserves and who doesn't, and who is a good person and who isn't, who is generous and who isn't, who is intelligent enough to use riches intelligently for noble purposes, and who isn't. In other words, the simplest idea of justice presupposes the reformulation of all our moral concepts. and intellectual concepts and social concepts. And of course, again, you know, it's a well-known conundrum of such things that, of course, the power will go to those who do the redistribution, and so on and so forth. I won't have to quote to you the old conservative conundrums. Nevertheless, intelligent ones. So you see, if indeed justice is defining justice is so much dependent on a proper analysis of institutions, it's so much dependent on a proper analysis of moral notions, going as far as to question the logic whereby we attain those moral notions, right? In that respect, you have to realize more or less the same conflict that confronted the great revolutionaries in 1917, that, may I mention to you, next year there will be 100 years from the October Revolution. Would you believe that? And so, you know, the problem, namely, that the main tool of a real critique of society is philosophical in nature, is theoretical in nature, that the moral sentiment as such, so important in, as you know, in the philosophy of history by very great minds, you know, in the 18th century, moral sentiments are not reliable, not because we have a pessimistic anthropology that sentiments are by necessity misleading. We have to prove that. I don't quite believe that. But that everything has to be re-examined, and this examination needs a critical activity that cannot remain content with the fundamental intuitions of justice, for example. So therefore, if you, without any institutional critique, you attempt, for example, institutional will encompass economy and culture and so many things. You will say that we want justice, then thereby you said only something else. Because by let's have justice means follow me. Follow me. That's always nice to say, and nice to feel that people, you know, love you and follow you, but it's hardly sufficient.
We already have a number of questions. So
yeah.
Francesco Tava was first. I think you need this for the recording.
Thank you for your talk. I was wondering, you have outlined how, for you, solidarity in today's society has no space, basically, if not in this form of utopia or this apparent empty form. Nonetheless, I think that, European institutions, well, all the basic, most important treaties of the European Union often use the word solidarity. For example, the Treaty of Lisbon. In the Treaty of Lisbon, solidarity is called like one of the basis fundaments of Europe.
Yes, I was told today by somebody who knows that 22 times.
Yeah, that's the point. And that's interesting, not just solidarity between between European states, but also between among European citizens, when the same idea of European citizen could be actually put into question from your point of view, I guess. And also, for example, in political theory, Habermas, for example, in his attempt to redefine a new constellation of European institutions, has also used this idea of solidarity as a possible tool in order to realize this possible reorientation and reconstellation. So I would like to ask you if you see in solidarity as it is used at the level of European institutions today only an empty word, or also, in view of a possible political project, also a tool which could be used in a new way somehow. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I'm very sorry to give you another gloomy answer, but I don't believe these folks. That's the first very elementary level. For a very simple reason, that solidarity really presupposes Very minimal, because that's not a philosophical concept, but it still presupposes a sort of a conceptual framework in which it is contained in some elemental way the fight of a more equitable society, at least, and therefore it cannot be a part of a founding document of an already existing institutional arrangement. You know, it's a demand, it's not a foundation. It is a call for change, it's not a call for respect. I know that they might mean it honestly, subjectively. I don't think that they as persons are necessarily liars, like all pillars of the establishment that Jürgen Habermas had become in the last 3-4 decades or whatever it was. And yeah, why not? I mean, probably are nice and kind and honest pillars of the establishment. He's probably one of the best candidates for that. And I haven't seen many. And you see, so therefore you cannot base the establishment on a demand for its change. Just, you know, so that's... But does the Lisbon Treaty call for a new establishment? It calls for the establishment that it establishes. And yeah, you know what I mean. I'm not joking. I'm not joking. It's a foundation document of a political arrangement, a para-state of some sort. You know, of course, it's full of noble intentions. Most constitutions are, and I'm not laughing at them. They're important. This, of course, I can translate it. Of course, solidarity and respect. It means, you know, what I said: welfare state and peace, basically. That was the origin of the common market. And there's another thing, too, which is a sort of a soft interdiction of ethnic discrimination and gender, possibly also gender discrimination. So therefore, we have this, you know, this Beethovenian and Schillerian sentiment that we stick together as equal, as people equal in dignity, and so on and so forth, and not just any masses. And yes, so in this respect, you know, solidarity means, of course, equilibrium and harmony and peace and tranquility in a conflictual world. It's the other dream, not mine, but it is still utopian, although it doesn't coincide with the utopia of the workers' movement, obviously. And so in this respect, it remains stubbornly utopian. Well, at least that's my impression.
Thank you for mentioning the centenary of the Russian Revolution, which is next year. May I remind you that you've mentioned the word utopia 6 times, and also someone in the audience mentioned
it. I might still.
And may I also mention that this year will be the 500th anniversary of the publishing of Thomas More's Utopia, of which I've noticed there's a distinct lack of commemoration. So I'd like to go back to what you said earlier about Rhodesia, and I'd like to put to you that maybe Rhodesia is a false analogy to use in terms of commemorating Utopia, and I wonder if a better analogy really is Atlantis, to which les Domnes de la Mer are approaching. So do you agree with Atlantis being a better analogy than Rhodesia? And could you also comment on the commemorations about the publishing of Utopia, right, apart from a conference at this institute?
Right. So, you know, I'm shocked that I thought that unbeknownst to me, the celebrations are going on. That was my assumption. But I believe you that they are not. And I suppose that, of course, that, you know, all the fireworks are, you know, being set up. And if not, we should do something about it. But yes, well, you know, all these utopias are pretty scary. And that's part of their charm. And... what's happened to this? And I don't know, you know, what of the similes are better. When I spoke of Rhodesia, I spoke of situation in which colonial occupation is not exercised by a foreign power. That's all I meant, basically. Maybe it's a clumsy comparison, but that's all I meant. Because, you know, in today's world, of course, the colonial oppression and colonial servitude are imposed not by explicitly foreign powers. And it happens, but it's not the most typical. And yes, I think that we can indeed become a world in which some privileged locations and some privileged groups and classes and even regions can still exercise some toleration among white folks, while in other places repression and savage repression being exercised. That's possible, that's the Rhodesian model, of course, in which indeed a genteel lifestyle was, of course, indeed experienced by the settlers, and not anything like that by the rest. And the fact that to which Europeans attach an undue importance, that we have been here earlier than the immigrants. You know, I come from Transylvania, you see, and my Transylvania Hungarian, and I heard all my childhood that it was the Romanians who were there before us. I'm very familiar with this argument that the Thracian Empire was earlier than the Hungarian hordes of Asia that came, etc. Now, so you know, this kind of sindered and clashing societies in which superiority and inferiority, separation and segregation grow into foundation stones of a new kind of statehood, that, although of course it's an abstraction and an exaggeration, but exaggerations are used legitimately to accentuate some features of a connection between facts. So I know it's an exaggeration. But and indeed, some of the utopian thinking has been indeed complicit in such practices and in other tyrannical practices. And indeed, the first real communist utopia was, after all, based on slavery, if I'm not very much mistaken. And so nobody's exempt. There's no guarantee. I don't think that morally noble and magnanimous goals are more likely to happen between people who are making a clean break with the existing order. Because this is infirmed by history. Many people who were very bravely breaking with the present order, as we know, have become very terrible tyrants. And so all this is all true. At the same time, I'm reluctant to use the word utopia in a negative fashion only. And of course, utopias are of many kind, but allow me to speak, for brevity's sake, to speak about it in general to the extent as possible. Utopias as descriptions of ideal states without due attention being paid to the possibility of the realization are useful in many ways. But first, of course, is the control that comparison allows, that you can compare your present condition with something else, which is useful because it gives you a moral vantage point and it saves you from thinking that your conditions are part of an historical, eternal order of things, which of course it's never the case. But there's another thing too. It is a way to transform insurgent ideas into tales, into stories. Stories are, a very effective part of the toolkit of humankind. And this is small wonder that religions used it.
last answer seems to me to somewhat modify or qualify the very bleak or pessimistic tone of the rest of what you said, which where you said, for example, political action can never be transformative. Maybe it can. But anyway, that wasn't my question. My question was really, I want to ask you a question that you asked yourself, but I didn't get what the answer was. You asked, how can you fight for tolerating immigrant foreigners? You asked that question. And
did I?
Yes. That was one of the questions. I mean, I wrote it down as you said it. How are we?
I believe you.
How are you?
I asked this myself.
How are you to fight for tolerating immigrant foreigners? And I wanted to ask you that question, maybe reformulating it slightly, in relation to the theme of your talk, because you talked about justice and you talked about solidarity. So, I think the question I want to ask is, how can we hope for an outcome where immigrants are tolerated better and indeed actually accepted from asylum seekers and so on? How can we hope to have that situation improved, that's to say more immigrants being accepted and tolerated? What kind of language is likely to bring that nearer to being fruition? In other words, faced with what we see in Europe, especially Eastern Europe, especially in your country, actually, namely a massive resistance to this, what kind of language is more likely to be effective? And in particular, since you've been talking about justice and solidarity, does either of these rhetorics have any prospect of changing the resistance that seems now to be so present?
I could answer with a single word, no. But I won't. Not only because I'm loquacious, but I am, but not because of that. But you see, I really don't think that toleration would help. Emancipation would help. And there's a world of difference between the two. Because, of course, you tolerate people whom you conceive of as different from yourself. And this is not what they need. They need sameness in the most important respects. Not this silly cultural adaptation, integration people are talking about, but that might be a subordinate problem. But they need sameness, the sameness as members of the human race. Is indeed a human race the conceptual and political basis of a regime of fairness, of justice and of solidarity, or is it not? And such a problem, the massive influx of foreigners in a given country, that if you preserve the basic notions on which these states are built, which is mostly, which I've shown in my, sorry for quoting myself, in my study in Boston Review that is called Post-Fascism, published in 2000, in the year 2000, 16 years ago, that citizenship is a privilege. Citizenship, that is political liberty, it's not a universal condition. It belongs in any given place only to citizens. And the citizens have the gift, gift to bestow on others at will of enlarging and extending that privilege to others. Well, that's not emancipation. That is simply a beneficent political action, a gift offered to the deserving, be they defined as the legal order of any given polity will establish it. So if indeed the states such as they are being preserved, then there's no solution to this problem. But that's obvious. I mean, look around you. Because you see the difference between the bloody racists and, you know, the enemy, at least to me, right, and my left liberal friends, the conceptual differences are but slight. Because they both are wanting to, well, of course, the moral difference is huge. Of course, some are good people and other bad people. That's a great difference. But conceptually, what are they saying? Let's use the same kind of exclusionary state generously. And the others say, no, don't use them generously. But they are both talking about the same kind of state. And that is really the great fight that we're witnessing. Long live our state, provided it's generous. Long live our state, provided that it's racist. But long live capitalism in both cases. I really don't think that this is a solution, because we see that it's not a solution and it cannot be. Because you see, a non-universal state, which we in normal circumstances accept, and it has its uses, and may be the only possible kind. What do I know? Well, that is unable to deal with outsiders. Fundamentally, in history, what are the two main ways in dealing with foreigners? The one is commerce, the other is war. This is two things that are connecting people's belonging to different political communities, different nations, different cities, whatever. And here neither can solve the problem, because these people don't want to overturn our governments, they don't want to occupy our lands, they don't want to set up another set of polity, they just want to come here and be fed, right? In other words, they too are recognizing our order, and this is why they are not resisting it effectively, right? Why are these huge masses of people so cool? You know, other people in their place, I might mention, would have blown up the whole bloody thing long ago. And they're not. These terrorist acts have very little to do with the immigrants' goals. They don't want to establish the Sharia and the Islamic theocracy. They want to get social aid. They want to get jobs. They want to get a house. And they want to have some quiet to think about things. Okay? So, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you so much. You never mentioned the word hegemony, which is... seems to be quite appropriate in the context of what you are driving at. Yeah. So according to the conventional definition of hegemony, in Gramscian version, it takes place when those who are subjected to dominance agree to think or even think in the categories of those who dominate. Yeah, but the first question is, if you understand your own intellectual activity as a kind of counter-hegemonic struggle, and I forgot where I have read it when I dealt with philosophy. It was a long time ago. I switched to political science. I remember that someone wrote that it is not about legitimacy. So it's not because those who are dominated agree with those who dominate, but it's not because they found this status quo legitimate, but only because they do not see the alternative. They do not see any other option. So the crucial question is these conditions of possibility. Yeah? C- conditions to act. So, and what you invite us to think, it requires, maybe it requires too much imagination. So it requires to imagine the quite different world. So, but what are the signs? Signs of these conditions which would allow us to imagine it.
Yes. Well, it's a very brief answer because the time is going. It's signs can always be quoted. Always signs of the times, portents, indications of. But I won't quote those because they're just, they're always present and there are no guarantees of anything. And so I really think that hegemony is a very useful notion. And with one major defect, that it presents, at least in the hands of some our contemporaries, as a too easy instrument of change. Because indeed the problem is that the downtrodden, of course, I agree with the oppressors in lack of an alternative, then indeed a change of language and the change of thinking and of feeling can indeed do the work. And I doubt that. So this is why I'm reluctant to use it in any prospective way. There was a young gentleman.
Just to be somewhat contrarian at the moment, just theoretically, what if the whole theory of reification doesn't really work, let's say reification does happen and everyone basically works on getting more money and getting their pensions at the end of the day, which is what reification in the end comes down to, I think. I read a piece the other day which says that if there isn't large amount of economic immigration into Europe in the next 30 or 40 years, the pension systems will just collapse the way in which, admitting a system of reification, right, the pensions are funded because they're funded by more workers coming in and younger workers paying for older workers, for retired workers. Wouldn't that be an argument on a completely capitalist and, system of reification world for actually accepting more immigrants, whether they're refugees or economic immigrants, into Europe?
I understand. It has been tried. The question is, why doesn't it work? Because it would stand to reason. Indeed, there are some advantages to immigration. That's quite. Economists and demographers will tell you that it will, or it could, at least. Why doesn't it work? Because of course it doesn't address the original problem. Because you see, people don't resist emigration primarily because they think that it endangers them economically, and that they have other reasons, mostly the desire to conserve a world that they cannot conceive otherwise because they don't have an idea of change. Therefore, our generation of all of us, people younger than me and a few who are even older than me, are bound to feel that is the present existent order of thing collapses, nothing remains after it. There's no horizon beyond it. So, people are just afraid of radical change that might actually shatter the ground under their feet is a reaction of, well, not precisely fear, but a reaction that originates in lack of alternatives. And, like many other phenomena of this kind. And so this is why, people just won't listen to this. It has been proposed in Germany and in other places that indeed there is an advantage to immigration. People just won't listen. Won't listen because they're not interested in this. So, it would be, in principle, it would be quite a good device, but not at this political juncture, as indeed it has been tried. But thank you for the idea anyway.
Thank you for being tolerant. I will not
Valeria always has very good questions. So, but please try to keep it short and the answer as well.
Yes, the answer will be brief, please, I can promise, yes.
Of course, the very notion of reification is engaged with Marxist discourse, but still it is used also by other authors like Berger and Luckmann. And they claim precisely that at the level of macro-social phenomena, people are always reified. And here, my question comes from this point that, as I see, you are kind of skeptical about supranational constellations like the European Union. You are critical towards nation-state. So my question is, what kind of political macro-constellation is relevant to this project of genuine solidarity? What can it be?
Right. I think that historically and empirically, the days of such political contexts in which solidarity will be meaningful are past. What the future might bring, I don't know. And as to Berger and Luckmann, everybody can use any word they like. A society based on mediation through things and subordinated not to personal rule but to the rule of a concept, that is a reified society, and that wasn't the case before. So you can extend if you wish, if you want a pan-tragic worldview, but I just didn't believe in it. And the worries of pre-modern societies have been different. Well, not smaller than ours, but different. And you know, I don't. It's hardly worth talking about the European Union, because the European Union presents exactly as a problem the problem that it was called to solve. The European Union was created in order to supersede national conflicts, and now it's falling prey to national conflicts. Well, it's a dispiriting story. And it has been predicted by many, and it is small wonder, because it seems that the nature of capitalism is conflictual and warlike. There is no superior instance that can be stopped. There's never, in this sense, you're right, there's never been. It has been the idea of the Roman Empire to keep eternal peace. Novus Ordo Seclorum, it's in Virgil, not only in the American coins. Novus Ordo Seclorum, that's Virgil. Virgil describes the birth of the Principate of Augustus in saying that now a new order of things begins in which there won't be what we call unjust killing. So there won't be war fought for partial interests and for unjust causes, and possibly for anything. It will be a cosmos, a well-formed universe. That's what it means. The word, as you know, means beautiful. It means a well-formed, well-adjusted universe. Well, and that, the secret of which was in there a number of things. The rule of a single person, if you wish. The use of a superior culture, the Greek one, and the domination of a race, the Roman one. That will be the guarantee of true universality. Well, you know, I wouldn't be so happy about that, I'm afraid. Too modern, maybe. I mean, not there. Okay, well, thank you. You've been extremely kind to listen to such a length of time to me.